next, we're going to start with State of Ohio versus Levante Dukes. And Attorney Methick is here for the defendant. The state is not represented, so you will have 15 minutes to present your argument. And as you know, the arguments are being recorded. Are you comfortable?
I'm fine.
Standing?
Yeah.
With your leg?
I can make it.
Okay. So please keep your voice up and try to stay behind the podium. Of course, we've read the briefs and we're ready to proceed when you are on.
Thank you very much, Charlie. Good morning, Your Honors. May it please the Court, I am Alan Medvick. I am here representing the defendant and appellant in this matter, Levante Dukes. While Mr. Dukes and I have raised several assignments of error in our brief, we'll be using the bulk of my time here today, if not all of it, to speak about the third assignment of error regarding the violation of Mr. Dukes' speedy trial rights. I'm doing that because I think it's among the most clear, and in particular, I do not believe that the state properly understood or responded to my argument here, and I want to make sure that that is clear to the judges here. And I'll just run through the timeline of this case quickly, that Mr. Dukes was arrested on April 7th. He remained incarcerated throughout the pendency of this case, so as you know, that would mean that his trial needed to be brought, according to RC 294571, within 90 days, because each day was calculating as three. So at that time, his speedy trial date would have been July 6th of 2015. There was one pretrial where it is undisputed on April 30th that Mr. Dukes received a two-week continuance at his attorney's request, and that 2 weeks would push that out to July 20th. I would indicate that I would also like to point out the arraignment dates of this case. On April 24th, 2015, Mr. Dukes was arraigned on the original set of charges. And that was set for the 2 weeks later for April 30th for pretrial in front of the trial judge at that time. I don't think there's any dispute. The state has not argued that that pretrial date set after arraignment in accordance with local rule, that that time was charged to the defendant. That is time charged the state by statute and by local rule, and that local rule being 2104, subsection A and B. I think B is applicable, that the assigned judge shall arraign the defendant, and if there is not a plea of guilty entered, a pretrial shall be set within 3 weeks. This was 2 weeks later, so that would be within the required mandatory time of local rule. As I said, there was a first pretrial. At that pretrial, was continued for 2 weeks until May 14th, 2015. At that May 14th pretrial, several things were acknowledged. One, that at the first pretrial on April 30th, discovery on the original charges had been delivered to the defendant's counsel. So there is no tolling of time argued that they were waiting for discovery on those original charges, although that had been provided without request, and there's no additional time told or requested. The other thing that proceeds in that hearing is arraignment on supplemental charges, that additional charges of breaking and entering for a separate event were brought against Mr. Dukes. And at that time, he enters a plea of not guilty and requests a pretrial be set in 2 weeks. And that, again, per local rule, that time should not have been charged, and in the original entry of arraignment was not charged to Mr. Dukes. And so at that point, the only extension received or acknowledged in the record was July 20th, was 2 weeks, which would move the original date of trial out 2 weeks to July 20th, would have been a speedy trial date. The trial date was set after that date, and on July 21st, defendant's trial counsel entered a motion to dismiss based on violation of speedy trial issue.
Except for, wasn't there an agreed upon trial date in this case where the state and the defendant agreed on July 29th?
And I think that that July 29th date was entered. It was based on the representations of the only acknowledgement of that agreement. agreement would have been after the representations of the state that the speedy trial date was extended out that additional 2 weeks until the early part of August.
And did the defense counsel object to that when the state raised that issue?
I believe that the law is clear that it is a state's issue. The language is clear that it is the state and the trial court's burden to provide and to understand what the speedy trial date is. And there was not, if that trial date was set after that speedy trial date, at the date that was set, there was no waiver on the part, there was no acknowledgement or waiver.
So you're saying you could not agree to?
He could not agree to that without a waiver on the record by my client. So, at that point, and that is the crux of my argument, that July 20th was the end date, and that argument, the trial court heard the motion to dismiss, and then after that July 20th date went back, and on the morning of the reset trial in August, entered a non-proton order charging the continued time from that. It still calls that non-proton order a journal entry of arraignment in the record. There is no acknowledgement that this was a continuance of a pretrial or anything other than an arraignment, but does include the language that pretrial was requested by the defendant. Now, I would state that there's a few things with that. As I've indicated, local rule is not discretionary. It states that after arraignment on charges, a pretrial shall be set within 3 weeks. The assigned judge shall arraign the defendant and set a pretrial conference within 3 weeks from the date of arraignment. This clearly falls within that window of time. And that set pretrial cannot be time charged to the defendant. That's not just because the local rule requires a pretrial. That's also supported by other case law in Ohio, as I cite in my brief, that is State v. Reuschling, R-E-U-S-C-H-L-I-N-G, stating that a pretrial requested after arraignment cannot be charged to the defendant as a continuance. And that there are clear requests, there are clear requirements in an order setting a continued trial between beyond the speedy trial date that a trial court must oblige. They have to enter the date, they have to enter who has been charged the time, and they have to acknowledge why it's being done, if it is being done sui sponte. In this case, and the other requirement of that under State versus Seiler, is that entry be made prior to the expiration of the speedy trial window. So, in this case, the only order on the record is silent as to who the time is charged to, and I think properly so, because the time should have been charged to the state at any rate. And I think that even if there was some validity to the non-proton argument at the end of this, that non-proton order is obviously entered well after the expiration of that date, and I think would not cure the problem. Essentially, you're opening a window to allow the state and a trial court to correct its speedy trial error well after the expiration of that window, which is what would have happened here if we were a few weeks beyond that July 20th date, and at which point the trial court entered an order retroactively charging time to my client. And I think that is improper and unconstitutional, frankly, in violation of state law as well. I would also point out that at the same time, at that second arraignment on the supplemental charges, there was a long argument about bond in that, and you will see this in the May 14th transcript, which was included in the record. There was discussion about reducing the bond so that my client could have been released and out, and obviously this would not have been an issue for the state or the court at that time if they had lowered the bond and allowed him an opportunity. instead they kept him in, they found that a cash bond was appropriate, or some money bond, and he did not waive his speedy trial rights at any point. There is no record of that, and instead he was brought to trial beyond that 90 days. So, with that, talk about is the vandalism charge, which again I also think is quite clear that that was improperly charged. But I think the language in that case was simply erroneous. That the state, the jury instructions supplemented required a finding in excess of. It required a finding that was not articulated in the indictment. They required that
he was charged with NF4, and the court instructed on NF5 vandalism.
Yes, that is correct. And he was ultimately found guilty of NF4, which was the only indictment for which he was charged. And at that point, I think that was plain error, if not structural error.
Can't we just correct that?
I don't believe that you can. I think that he's on notice of what his charges should be, and I think that that's improper. He had an indictment in front of him that stated one thing, and he was then instructed on something completely different. I don't know that, and that was a 6-month sentence, which is running consecutive to all of the other charges, so at the minimum there's an additional 6 months on his sentence that he is suffering improperly. So I think at that point,
did the F5 instruction was it consistent with what the evidence was?
And I think what you will find in the record is that they found him guilty of an F5 based on their finding.
But the entry reads F4.
But the entry reads F4. He was only instructed on F4. But I don't think you cannot, while he had a right to be amended and charged with that, the state could either have amended the indictment to an F5, or they could have instructed on a lesser included, but they needed to do one or the other, and they did neither. And at this point, they simply, they would be asking this court to retroactively amend that indictment, which I don't believe you can do. I don't think that's within the authority to, and I don't think the trial court could go back and say, well, we meant to try it as an F5, even on remand. So
there was no request for a lesser included.
No.
No objection to the F5 instruction.
Correct. There was not a request for that, and there was, but it was also the state's burden as to what is being charged as well. So, with that, if there are no other questions,
I'm just thinking of the case law with bench trials where someone is indicted on, let's say, an F5, and the defense counsel doesn't ask for the lesser included.
I cannot speak to that.
Okay.
I apologize. And
no,
I don't,
that's okay.
I don't know what this
I've just wrestled with that issue over the years, so it's something that I've...
And I don't know what the significance of this being a jury trial would be, because obviously in a bench trial,
right,
you're dealing with a different set of circumstances. You're not dealing with giving people instructions. It's a matter of... It's a different set. It's a different animal, almost entirely.
So there was no, this was a bench trial, so there was no jury instruction on that.
This was a jury trial.
Oh.
No, I was talking about other cases where bench trials are involved.
Thanks for clearing that up. When you asked the question about.
No, and
I just wondered if that was something that, you know, was a general rule of law, even with jury trial. I understand your argument.
And my experience is that it is not that if you, especially in a jury trial, you have to specifically instruct, and if you do not find them guilty, you may subsequently consider this lesser included offense, but not, and find them guilty thereof. And with that, if there are no other questions, I concede about that time.
All right.